in front of me, and I pulled out the Delta Sky magazine, and I was flipping through the pages trying to find something interesting. And they actually had a one-page overview on New York City's Diamond District. And it's really kind of fascinating. If you've never been there, it says, spanning the, West 47th Street between 5th and 6th Avenues in Midtown Manhattan, and this is very important, it's one block long. Okay, so you've got the Diamond District, Midtown Manhattan, 47th Avenue, one block. It's the center of the diamond trade since the 1940s. It says a movement is afoot to clean up the charmingly grungy stretch with its mixture. There's a international gem tower opening the next year or so. So visit it while it's still a little gritty. But here's what was interesting. There are 4,100 businesses in that one block stretch of New York City. That's the number of diamond and jewelry businesses on 47th Street. Includes retailers, wholesalers, and diamond manufacturers working out of storefronts or even out of stalls. With those 4,100 businesses, there are 32,000 employees. And on a daily basis, they transact approximately $400 million worth of business. The economic impact of that diamond and jewelry business to New York City is $24.1 billion per year, all in one little street in New York. Having read that, and then I really had to go there, so the next time I was in New York, I walked down there, and I'll tell you, it's exactly as it was projected here. It's grungy and a little bit gritty. And when I looked, you found no gold. All right? The Bible, though, tells us that there is a city. You know, Kyle, can I ask you to do me a favor? Somehow I'm bumping the wrong one. Would you move us forward when I ask you to? Thank you. I'm going to ask if we would look up Revelation 21, 15 to 21. I have had the opportunity to be in a number of large cities around the country for various reasons. And I will tell you, I have never found one city that has gold streets. But the Bible tells us that such a city does exist. And I'm going to ask us to read that here a moment, Revelation 21, verses 15 through 17. If you're there, would you say amen? All right, sounds like we're ready to go. He says, and he who talked with me had a gold reed to measure the city and its gates and its wall. The city is laid out square. Its length is as great as its breadth. And he measured the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs. Its length, breadth, and height are equal. Then he measured its wall, 144 cubits, according to the measure of man, that is, of an angel. The construction of its wall was of jasper, and the city was pure gold like clear glass. The foundations of the wall of the city were adorned with all kinds of precious stones. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third chalcedony, the fourth emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth sardius, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, the 11th jacinth, the 12th amethyst. The 12 gates were 12 pearls. Each individual gate was of one pearl. And here's how it ends, with this description of heaven. And it says, and the street of the city was pure gold, like transparent glass. So friends, there really is a city that has streets of gold. And we're not going to find it on earth, but we'll find it in heaven. And I thought about this verse when I was reading that information about New York. And how in all of the economic value that's happening just in that one little block, and how just the crumbs from that, just the crumbs that brushes off the dust, that brushes off, was enough to sustain someone for a living. And I got to thinking, if that's what can happen in just one city block here on earth, I wonder how much the streets of gold in heaven might be worth. Have you ever thought that? Now, no one in their right mind would ever accuse me of being a mathematician, but I do like to play with numbers. And so I went through a little numbers exercise, and Kyle, if you'd move us to the next screen here a minute, I decided to just go through an exercise of trying to figure out how much would the streets of gold actually be worth. So we have to kind of back into that number, and let's start with the information that we have. We know that the size of heaven is 12,000 stadia long and wide, which would be approximately 1,400 miles long and wide. All right. Now, before I go any further, I recognize there are several ways to interpret that text. It could be literal in the sense that it's 12,000 furlongs long, 12,000 wide, 12,000 high, or the 12,000 could be the sum of those three. I decided to go with a larger one, and I'll tell you why. As we're going through this process, I think it's going to be very, very hard to overestimate the value. Fair enough? So I'm going to start with the larger size. So what we end up with is we've got a city that's approximately just under 2 million square miles for a size. So what do we do with 2 million or 1.96 million square miles? Well, I went to the city of Grand Rapids. Grand Rapids has an area of 45 square miles, and in that 45 square miles, there's 589 miles of roads. So let's extrapolate that. That's approximately 13 miles of road for every square mile of city. And if we take that one step further, we've got 1.96 square miles with 13 miles of street per square mile. That gives us, in heaven, approximately 25.5 million miles of street. So how much would the gold be worth? Well, let's take that one step further. 25 million miles of street. Let's assume that streets are 40 feet wide and 2 feet thick. Now, I have a tendency to believe that the streets are going to be far thicker than that. All right, we're operating, God's going to be making this with pure glass. But because we're operating with a realm where we're trying to put a human perspective on this, let's just make the assumption that they're 40 feet wide, they're 2 feet thick. That gives us over 10 trillion cubic feet of gold in the city. All right, and we're just getting started. Let's go on to the next one, Kyle. If you've got 10.77 trillion cubic feet of gold and gold weighs 1,200 pounds per cubic foot, that means we've got almost 13 quadrillion pounds of gold. If we multiply that by 16, we end up with 208 quadrillion ounces of gold. And with gold at $1,188 per ounce as of Thursday afternoon, that gives us 247 quintillion dollars worth of gold. Okay? Now, can anyone here wrap their mind around the size of that? All right? We're dealing now with numbers that are really unfathomable. So let's try to put that in some type of perspective. In other words, is there some type of anchor that we can use that makes this number more understandable? So let's put it this way. If God earned 2.5% on all of that money, on the value of heaven's gold and streets, each year, the earnings of that gold would be about just under $12 trillion every minute. Okay? So in other words, if God said, I'm going to convert these golden streets, or maybe they're not manufactured yet, or maybe he has the same amount in reserve somewhere, he says, I'm going to take that gold, I'm going to convert it to cash, I'm going to put it in a bank, I'm going to get 2.5% interest each year on that, he would make, or that gold would earn, almost $12 trillion every single minute. And now I want to, even that number is pretty large, so let me put in perspective what $12 trillion is, or 11.7 trillion dollars is the same amount as a 10% tithe and a 5% offering on the entire economy of the world for a year. And God could earn that from the golden streets in 1 minute. That's how much it's worth. Okay? Are we starting to understand just how much God is worth? Unfortunately, there's a lot more. Let's go on. October 11, 2012, a planet made of diamond twice the size of Earth. Now, you would think that you would see something like that on a National Enquirer, right? Okay, this is not from the National Enquirer. This is from ABC News, CBS News. These are, apparently the reputable organizations, and this is what they had to say. Scientists have found a diamond planet called 55 Cancri E that is made up of 30% diamond. The planet is also called Super Earth because it is twice the size of the Earth, but it has a mass 8 times more than the Earth, and it is visible to the naked eye orbiting a star in the constellation of Cancer. Let's move on to the next one, Kyle. It says, the mysterious planet has a surface of graphite, below which is a thick layer of diamond that encases a layer of silicone carbide. The core is made of iron. But if you're thinking about picking up your shovel and heading there, you need to realize that you're going to need to spend about 40 light years to get there. Also, the planet has a temperature on the surface of approximately 3,900 degrees Fahrenheit. So it'd be a little difficult to live there. I wish Christian McDonald was here. I would ask him if SpaceX is planning a journey to there. But the question would be, how much would that planet be worth? Well, Forbes, we move on to the next one, Forbes has actually estimated that. And according to Forbes magazine, one more, Kyle, anyone want to take a guess what that number is? 26.9 nonillion dollars. Okay. Now, remember we were talking about 247 quintillion? That was the value of the gold on Heaven's streets. Just the streets, not the foundation, not the walls, not the buildings, anything, just the streets. You would need approximately the same number of Heaven's golden streets. In other words, that 247 quintillion multiplied by 247 quintillion heavens to come up with this number. And that's just one planet. We go on to the next one, Kyle. Right now, scientists estimate that there are over 250,000 diamond planets in the universe. I wonder what it's like for us when we actually start to try to measure the immeasurable or fathom the unfathomable, that we begin to realize that God cannot be measured. And I wonder if we come to the place where we actually start to look and say, where do I fit into all of that? And I think David asked the question best. We can move on to the next slide. And he said this. He said, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him. Psalms 8:4. He also said, O Lord, what is man that you care for him? The son of man that you think of him. Job said almost the same thing. If we can move on to the next slide again. I'm going to just try this. There we go. I think I got it. What is man that you make so much of him, that you give him so much attention, that you examine him every morning and test him every moment? Job 7:17. It's an awesome thing for us to look at who we are in comparison to what we can only imagine God to be. And we recognize really how small we are. You know, it's very easy for us to think as we go through our lives how important we are. In fact, I would tell you that's one of the signs of the Laodicean church, is we walk around, the Bible tells us, there's two specific descriptions. We are rich and we're in need of nothing. And I wonder if sometimes we need to be reminded actually what our place is when we compare ourselves to God. But there's a second question that comes to mind, not only who are we as compared to God, but just as importantly, okay, wrong way. Let's go one more time, Kyle. There we go, one more time. That's this. If God is so wealthy, why does he need our money? Have you ever asked yourself that? You know, we'll often stand here and we'll have the offering call and we'll talk about the fact that we need to give. God needs us to give so we can go out and accomplish his work. And I guess the question would be this. If we've just looked at the fact that God, if God gave 1 minute's worth of interest, 1 minute's worth of interest on the golden streets, it would be as much as if every man, woman, and child, every business, every organization, everything on earth gave an honest 10% tithe and an additional free will offering. For the year, God could accomplish that in 1 minute. If that's the case, then why does he ask us to give our money? Why is it that he needs us to give? The thing, the conclusion that I think what we need to come to is this. God doesn't need our money. It's easy to think that. And in fact, if I was honest, if they had asked, and I'm kind of glad they didn't, they had asked, what was your sermon title going to be? The honest answer would probably be, God doesn't need you, and he needs your money even less. And I'm going to ask you not to take my word for that. If we could go on to the next slide here, I'm going to ask us to consider something from the book Counsels on Stewardship. Ellen White wrote this. She said, the Lord does not need our offerings. We cannot enrich him by our gifts. The gold and silver are the Lord's, and he could rain them from heaven if he chose. Now, we've read that before. I want to put one last perspective on this. This says, the Lord does not need our offerings. We cannot enrich him by our gifts. We know that, don't we? I mean, this is not the first time we've heard that. But I want to put one last perspective on the idea of how much wealth God has. And I want us to go back to the value of that diamond planet. Okay, 26.99 million, and there's 250,000 of them out there. And we can't begin to understand what that value is, right? But let's pretend that we have this number and the ratio of that number to all of humanity paying a tithe and offering today. We know what that number is. It's just under $12 trillion. So you have this huge value of God's diamond planets, and we have the $12 trillion. And in the subject of math, a lot of times we learn something early on called ratios. In other words, if you have 8/16, can you reduce that down to something a little bit smaller? And sure, you can reduce that down to 1/2. Or you take a 4/20, and you can reduce that down to 1/5. So let's try to reduce that number down to something that we can really understand. All right? So the value of God's diamond planets compared to what he's asking us as humanity to give. And let's take that value of the diamond planets and make it something manageable. Let's call it all of the earnings of the world for 1 year. $78 trillion is what it was in 2015. Big number, hard for us to understand. But let's imagine that as humanity, someone's going to come and give us on the equivalent ratio what we're being asked basically to give to God. How many here think that that number would be more than $100? Anyone? Anyone think it would be more than $10? Anyone think it would be more than a dollar? Anyone think it would be more than a penny? Okay, you guys on the right track. If you could cut a penny in half and in half and in half, actually you would be wasting your time, because in the end, the equivalent ratio is if someone came to us and offered us 1/2 of 1 atom of copper, would be the equivalent of us giving our tithes and offerings to God, the entire world, for 1 year. And now I want us to read that again. It says, the Lord does not need our offerings. We cannot enrich him by our gifts. If we go on to the next slide, it talks a little bit more about the fact that God has some other things to say. God could have reached his object in saving sinners without the aid of man. God is not dependent upon men for the advancement of his cause. He might have made angels the ambassadors of his truth. The Bible tells us, by the way, how many angels there are. Now, again, I don't know if this is a literal or a figurative number. The Jews had a way of measuring, and they were limited in their numbers. They could only go up to 10,000. And so when they wanted to emphasize a number beyond what they could measure, they would say 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, which is basically a way of saying the same thing twice. But if you actually use those as literal numbers, you've got 200 million angels. And I would imagine that 200 million angels could accomplish God's work about as fast as that minute of interest. Am I right? If we are really serious about what the capabilities are of perfect godly beings, I think we would find ourselves falling far short in comparison. So we read that. It says, God is not dependent upon men for the advancement of his cause. He might have made angels the ambassadors of his truth. So now we have a conundrum. If we listen to what Ellen White is saying, if we're honest about what we see when we actually try to measure God, we're faced with a bit of a conundrum. Because the reality is that God doesn't need us, but he still asked us. The fact that he doesn't need us doesn't mean that he hasn't asked us to be part of the work, and it doesn't mean that he hasn't asked us to give. And so the question is, why is he asking us to participate? You know, when I was in grade school, 7th and 8th grade, we were living in Wisconsin at the time, a little country school, Bethel Junior Academy. And at lunch every day, it was a very conservative school. It was wonderful. I have wonderful memories there. Our teacher would allow us to listen to the radio, one station, during lunch. My good friend Mike Rudinger had a radio, and by the way, I hate to date myself, this is before there was anything even like Sony Walkmans, let alone the technology that we have today. So Mike had a little square transistor radio. It had those little, you know, things, slot or buttons or whatever on the side. You flick them on and the radio comes on. There's another little button that you roll and that adjusts your stations. And we got to listen every day to Paul Harvey. Okay, you guys, anyone else ever heard Paul Harvey? And what do we know about Paul Harvey? He could tell a great story, and always at the end of the news, he would end with something, and it was called The Rest of the Story. Exactly. And he would start out by explaining something, and at the very end, he would tell us something different, and it would head us in a different direction, and we would say, aha, that was memorable. And I'm wondering if what we're reading here, there's more to it than what we've just seen. So let's move on to the next slide. It says, God is not dependent upon men for the advancement of his cause. He might have made angels the ambassadors of his truth. He might have made known his will as he proclaimed his law from Mount Sinai with his own voice. But in order to cultivate a spirit of benevolence in us, he has chosen to employ men to do this work. You see, God is asking us to be part of the work, not just for what it does out there, but because of what it does right here. I'm going to go on to the next one, because she says something again. He says, that man might not lose the blessed results of benevolence, our Redeemer formed the plan of enlisting him as his co-worker. God could have reached his object without the aid of man, but he knew that man could not be happy without acting a part in the great work. You see, there's something built into us, something created in us that God put there that says when you are part of the work, it will actually bring you happiness. And you think about the misery that exists in the world today and how much more happiness there would be if society as a whole, if humanity as a whole, would engage in the work of God. We're told right here we can't be happy without it. And there's one last thing that she says. Number of things. One last thing that I'm going to point out here today, if we go on to the next slide, it says the Lord does not need our offerings. We cannot enrich him by our gifts. The gold and silver are the Lord's, and he could rain them from heaven if he chose. But instead of this, he has made man his steward, entrusting him with means not to be hoarded, but to be used in benefiting others. This is my bold and underlined. God planned the system of beneficence in order that man might become like his creator, benevolent and unselfish in character, and finally be a partaker with Christ in the eternal glorious reward. You see, friends, we come to church every week, and with good intentions, we're here thinking about the work that needs to be done out there. And there is work to be done out there. But we come not intentionally with this arrogance, but the idea is we're here and we're the ones that are saved, and God has asked us, because we're rich and we don't need anything, to give our money and go out there and do the good work of saving the souls that are outside this church. And the reality is God has asked us to be part of this work because who he really wants to save is me. What he really wants to save is you. He knows that in all of what's going on, one of the most important ways that he can capture our heart and begin to change us into the character of Christ is if we go through the process of giving. And so he asks us to give not because we can give back to him more than what he has. He asks us to give because it will change our life. And that's the reason that we're asked to give. There's a caution, though, that we have to be careful of. It's very easy for us at times, we've heard this before, well, I don't know if I want to give because I don't want to feel like I'm buying my way into heaven. And I would tell you that that's not what God's talking about. That's not the condition of a giving heart. If we think back to the whole system that God set up, back with the children of Israel, with the sacrifices, everything being done to point forward to the heavenly sanctuary. There was a time that God actually said, I hate your sacrifices. I abhor them. A contrite heart is what I desire. Now, that doesn't mean there was anything wrong with that system. In fact, it was God-ordained. It was God-designed. The problem was that the heart wasn't involved. So I want to encourage us today is that the giving of tithes and offerings is not a way to buy our way into heaven. And I would caution us not to look at others as a way of saying whether we should give or not. In fact, I would tell us the most important thing, if we're desiring to have the character of Christ, is that we need to look at Christ for our example. I'm going to ask us, flip the slide one more time, Kyle. I'm going to ask us to look up a text. Actually, it was our opening text here this morning, Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16 and verses 24 to 26. It says, then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. What profit it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? Friends, I don't want to gain the whole world and lose my own soul. I'm hoping that you don't either. And if that's what we desire not to be, then let's go back earlier in that reading, and it will tell us what we need to do to avoid that. That's one of the great things about the Bible. The Bible will answer its own questions. If we're worried about that situation, I don't want to become that, let's go back and see what it says. And it says, if anyone desires to come after me, three things: deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. He also, not only does he give us the three things, but he gives it to us in order. And I'm going to ask us to think about this. A lot of times we talk about what it's like to follow Jesus. A lot of times we talk about what it's like to pick up our cross. I don't believe we can do any of those until we start at the beginning. And that's, what is it really like to deny ourselves? And if we want to understand what it's like to deny ourselves before we can take up our cross, I think we need to look at what Christ did to deny himself before he took up his cross. And so I'm going to ask, again, if we can move on to one more slide, I'm going to take just a couple minutes here. I'm going to ask us to contemplate what happened before Christ was crucified on the cross. The Bible talks about the fact that Jesus had had 3.5 years of ministry, healing and preaching and teaching. And that last week of his life came, and he makes the trek with his disciples to Jerusalem. And just very briefly, we'll run through the next couple days. There's the triumphal entry. Jesus weeps over the city. He recognizes that his own people don't accept him. They go into the city. One last time, he cleanses the temple from the money changers. One of the last days shows up. He sends his disciples on to prepare the upper room, and he meets with them there. And he realizes that that's his last night. His disciples really aren't clued into it. No matter what he's saying, he spends that whole evening with the last instructions, the last encouragements. His disciples have other things in mind. James and John are trying to figure out who's going to be the most important in heaven. Judas is figuring out the last strategies for him to force Jesus' hand by betraying him. Peter, in his arrogance, thinks that nothing's going to happen where he'll ever deny Christ. And Christ humbly and lovingly and kindly gives them the last instructions that they need. We're told that he even washes their feet. And when that service is done, the Bible tells us, and we've heard it before, we say this often at communion, that they sung a hymn and then they left. I want to talk about what happened after they left. Ellen White talks about the fact that they left from there and they went to the Garden of Gethsemane, and that was not unusual for them. They would often do that. Jesus would go there, and he and his disciples would pray for the evening, or they would rest for the evening. But there was something different this time. When they left the upper room, that process of the weight of sin began to descend on Jesus. And up until that point, he had been filled with the Holy Spirit. He had been in direct communication with his Father for all of his ministry. And he began to feel that separation slowly take place. And he began to feel the weight of what it meant to carry the sins of the entire world. And it was tough. It was difficult. We're told that as he began that journey, he became silent. His disciples noticed it, and they realized that something was going on, and they couldn't figure out, they didn't ask him. But as that journey progressed, there were several times where he groaned out loud as though carrying a terrible weight. His breathing became labored, and his steps became unsteady. And twice he would have fallen, except that his disciples held him up. They got to the opening of the garden, and he left the majority of his disciples outside, asked them to wait and pray, and he brought James and John and Peter with him into the garden. And as they went into the garden again, he asked them to wait and pray, and he moved on just a little bit further. Not so far that they couldn't see or hear him, but far enough that he could be alone. And he fell to the ground. And we're told that the agony of the sin of being separated from his father was almost more than he could bear. And in his humanity, he didn't know that he could go on. He wasn't sure that he would have the strength to do what needed to be done. He understood that he had to bear the wrath of God's the wrath of God against the transgression of sin. And he didn't think that he'd be able to endure it. And he felt like the sacrifice that he was being asked to make was too much. And I have a question for us here this morning. And the question is this: have you ever felt that giving an honest tithe and a free will offering, that you were being asked too much to do that? That whatever your circumstances in life, it seemed that God was asking too much of you to do that. That you didn't know how you would be able to do that. That it didn't seem possible. And if you've ever thought that, I want to tell you this. Jesus knows how you feel. Because for a brief time in the Garden of Gethsemane, in his humanity, he felt the same way about dying for us. The Bible tells us that he actually prayed to his Father, and in words that we would use today, he basically said, "God, don't make me go through this." And we're told there was no answer in heaven. It was silent. Jesus picked himself up, and he went back to where his disciples were, and he found them asleep, and he woke them up and said, "Please pray." He needed the prayers. He had spent his earthly ministry pouring himself into others. He needed something in return, but they were asleep. And so he went back after he woke them up and again fell to the ground. The devil was there in the garden and began to press upon him some of the most awful thoughts. And he reminded Christ that should he go forward with that sacrifice, that most people would reject it. It wouldn't be appreciated. It would be misused. It would be abused. It would be rejected. It would be meaningless in most cases for him to go on. Ellen White tells us that his agony was so bad that he clung to the ground as if somehow by holding on to the ground he could hold on to that relationship with God. And I want to ask you this question. For any of us here, have we ever thought that when we give, we don't want to give because we're not sure if we give, if that those monies will be misused or abused or not handled properly, if somehow it will be unappreciated, and if it seems to be overwhelmed by a sense of ingratitude from others around us for what we're doing? I want to remind you of this. Jesus knows exactly how you feel. He felt the same way in his humanity about dying for us. There's a second time that he went back and he prayed. And he asked his Father, again, in words that we use today, "Please don't make me do this." And there's no answer in heaven. And he goes back and he finds, again, his disciples asleep. And he longs for someone to be interceding on his behalf. And for the third time, he goes back to that area of privacy and he falls on the ground. And he begins to realize where he's at. Ellen White says it best. I'm just going to read it directly what she says. She says, "The awful moment had come. That moment which was to decide the destiny of the world, the fate of humanity, trembled in the balance. Christ might even now refuse to drink the cup apportioned to guilty men. It was not yet too late. He might wipe the bloody sweat from his brow and leave men to perish in his iniquity. He might say, leave the transgressor, let the transgressor receive the penalty of his sin, and I will go back to the Father. Will the Son of God drink the bitter cup of humiliation and agony? Will the innocent suffer the consequence of the curse of sin to save the guilty? There was an awful moment when the weight the fate of humanity hung in the balance, and Christ wrestled with whether he was going to go through with what he had been called to do. And I want to ask you this question. And the question is this. Have you ever thought that you don't deserve to have to be the one to make the sacrifice? Have you ever thought, you know, it's not my fault that finances are tight, it's not my fault that the situations are what they are, that we don't want to have the financial responsibility to take care of problems that maybe someone else created, and if it was up to us, we'd rather wash our hands and walk away from that situation than to have to sacrifice financially? And if we've ever thought that, I want to remind you one last time, Jesus knows how you feel, because he felt for a couple of awful moments in the garden, his humanity felt the same way about dying for us. For the third time, he utters the prayer, if it be possible, God, let that cup pass from me. And that final moment comes. Ellen White said that he saw the transgressors of the law, and that if left to themselves, they would perish. He saw the helplessness of man. He saw the power of sin. And he made his decision. With no promise, no assurance that that gift and that sacrifice would be received, number one, that it would be sufficient, and number two, that we would accept it. With no assurance, he made his decision. He will save man at any cost to himself. And he will not turn from his mission. And his prayer now is simply, not my will, God, but yours. Ellen White says he fell to the ground, and if it were not for the fact that the angel that stands in the presence of God himself descended immediately and revived him and restored him and encouraged him, he would have died right there. Friends, we are promised that if we will obey and follow, that God will bless us. But I wonder how many times we get that backwards. I wonder how many times, especially when it comes to giving, we're waiting for God to bless us first. We're waiting for God to say, okay, I'm going to give you the reward, I'm going to give you the blessing, and our comment is, as soon as you do that, God, then I will give. Then I will do that. I want the guarantees first. And I wonder how many times we miss the opportunity to have the character of Christ, to be able to say, God, I will give because I trust you. I will make that decision today and realize that you will provide the means later. But we make the decision now. I think, friends, that we get that backwards. And when we get it backwards, we miss the opportunity to be partakers in Christ's character. I'm going to ask us to go on. I want to, as we're coming to the conclusion here, what Ellen White says. Kyle, if we can move on to the next slide real quick here. It says, have we forgotten that infinite price paid for our redemption? Is gratitude dead in the heart? Does not the cross of Christ put to shame a life of selfish ease and indulgence? And moving on to the next slide as this continues. Oh, must Christ, the majesty of heaven, the King of glory, bear the heavy cross and wear the thorny crown and drink the bitter cup while we recline at ease, glorify ourselves, and forget the souls he died to redeem by his precious blood? No, let us give now while we have the power. Amen. Friends, there are, if this congregation is like any congregation across North America, perhaps anywhere around the world, there are people here that struggle with this. And what's interesting is that a lot of times we think to ourselves this idea, well, God calls us to do a lot of things. What's so important about the tithes and offerings? Well, number one, he's made it important, and so I'm not going to question that. But I'm going to ask you to think about this. Of all the things that God asks us to do, most of them seem at some point fuzzy or foggy or nebulous. I mean, we understand he's asked us, love our neighbor as ourselves. Okay, what does that mean, though? How can we prove that we're doing that? Of all the things that Christ and God have asked us to do, the most easily understood and measurable is the giving of our tithes and offerings. And if we can't do the one thing that is obvious, how can we ever go on and do the rest? So I think sometimes we need to start with what's easy, even though it may feel like it's hard. And I'm going to ask us to look at that last night. It says, no, he has let us give while we have the power. Friends, we're not going to have the power to give forever. I'm going to leave you with this last thought. And I'm going to ask you to think about this. There are a number here. I'm going to speculate. Again, this is just an average when we take a look at congregations. There are some that struggle with whether they can give or whether they choose to give. There are others that are giving. And I want you to think about this. Those of you even that are currently giving. Very, very quick story. When I was 15, I the first time ever I ran a mile in high school. It was spring picnic, and I was a sophomore in academy, and so the freshmen versus sophomores, juniors and seniors, and so I was asked to run a mile. I had never run a mile before. I don't know why they asked me. I showed up at the race. It was a grass field with a grass track around it. The other eight or seven kids, because there was eight of us, two from each class, were there ready to go. Most of them in their running shoes, their little running shorts, their really light little running tees. And I showed up in blue jeans and some kind of shoes that I guarantee you were not running shoes. And I had never run before. And I remember thinking, I don't know what I'm doing, but I do know this. When the race starts, I'm gonna put myself right behind everyone else, and I'm just going to try to keep up and hope for the best. So the gun went off, and I'm running barefoot in blue jeans around this track. And I got to the end of the first lap. It was a four lap to do the mile. And my legs were burning, and my lungs were killing me. And I thought to myself, I don't know how I'm going to keep doing this, but I've got to at least keep pace with everyone else. And so we finished the second lap, and we finished the third lap. And as we're going into the fourth lap, going across the back stretch, I remember thinking as I'm running behind everyone else, if I'm really serious about winning, at some point I'm going to have to make a move. And I don't know how I'm going to do that. But I can't wait too long, because if I do, everyone else is going to speed up and I'll never catch them. And I remember getting to that last couple feet of the back stretch as the track began to curve and realizing I have to do something and I have to do it now. And so I began to start to run a little faster. And a little faster, and a little faster. And I began to move to the outside, and I slowly began to catch up with everyone. And halfway around that last turn, I had caught up with a pack. I was running on the outside of them, and I kept running a little faster, and a little faster, and a little faster, and a little faster. And by the time we got through the curve, I was just in front of what had been the leader. And at that point, you could see the finish line in front of you, and I'm running almost full speed, and I sprinted those last couple yards, and no one caught me. And I won. Surprising. I had no idea I could do it. But here's what I'm going to tell you. I've had the opportunity to run races since then, in the last few years. And that same philosophy is I use in every race, every time I train. There's a pace at which any one of us can run a race, and it's what we call sustainable. We could probably, not indefinitely, the longer run's a little slower, the short run's a little faster, but there's a pace at which we say, I can probably do this for quite a while. But when we get to the end of the race, or towards the end of the race, my goal is, when I cross the finish line, I want to have left everything on the field. I don't want anything left. And so I begin to pick up the pace, and pick up the pace, and pick up the pace. What's very interesting about when I do that in an actual competition is most of the time when I get there, I still can't see the finish line. There's some bend in the road, there's a clump of trees, there's a curve in the path, something that keeps me from being able to see the finish line, but I know where I'm at because there are markers periodically through the race that tell me exactly where I'm at and how much more is left. And I know if I wait until I see the finish line, it will be too late, because it takes me a while to speed up. I'll be honest about that. The question I have for us, friends, is this as we wrap up. When I read my Bible, there are no more prophetic mile markers. There's nothing left in prophecy. My Bible tells me the next thing that's going to happen is that Michael's going to stand up, and there'll be a time of trouble since the world has never seen. There's nothing left. The finish line is, but because of a bend in time, we still can't see it. But I'm wondering, friends, if we listen, if we can hear the finish line, if we listen to what's going on, and more importantly, if it's time for us to start giving unsustainably. In a spiritual sense, when I get to the finish line, I want to have left it all here. There's none of it that we can take with us. I'm not asking people to start selling their homes, converting everything into cash, but I'm wondering, even for those of us who are giving, if maybe it's time to give just a little bit more. Time is short. God's coming again. Ellen White says, give while you have the power. And I want us to be reminded of one last thing. If we go on to this is the last slide. What Paul tells us. We are God's children. Now, if we are children, we are heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings. In order that we may also share in his glory. That's the promise. We have right here on earth a few years. I call it an intermission in eternity. We have all of eternity that stretches out before us without time. We have all of eternity that stretches out in front of us with no limit, no end. And we have just these few years here on earth. An intermission in eternity. And if we're willing to go through some of the sufferings with Christ, we could spend eternity sharing in his glory. That's my goal. And so my question is this. I'm going to ask three quick questions. Some of you will fall, hopefully, into each category. I'm going to ask you to stand, but do not stand until I'm done. If you have felt convicted that God is asking you to begin this journey of giving, and perhaps it's been a struggle before, and you said, I just don't know how I'm going to do that, God, but I feel impressed that God is asking me to do that. In just a minute, I'm going to ask you to stand. If you have been in the process of giving in the past, and you feel impressed that the Holy Spirit is saying, you know what, maybe it's time to take that next step. I think there's more that I can do. I'm going to ask you to stand. And finally this, if you feel that God has impressed you that what he's calling you to do more of is not necessarily of a financial means, but there is more that you can do to be part of his work, and have the character of God. I'm going to ask, whatever category that might be, if you're willing, would you stand with me today? And let's have a quick word of prayer. Dear God, you see the lives that are standing here today. As we contemplate again, to try to fathom the unfathomable or measure the immeasurable, something that our minds in our human state cannot even grasp, how awesome and majestic you are. For whatever reason, you have created us so that the greatest joy that we have is to share with you the work that needs to be done. And I pray, Lord, today that the decisions that have been made and the convictions that have been felt in the hearts of the people that are standing here today, that as they leave here, will not be forgotten. That you have promised to give us the courage, the faith, the strength to go forward. And I ask that, Lord, that it be poured out in abundance. In your holy name, amen. Our closing hymn today.